Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. When we want to see tiny details of something that is near to us, like in this leaf, we can magnify the image using a magnifying glass. Or if we want to see a much bigger image, then we use a microscope. We put the leaf on the microscope stage, cover it with a glass slide. Select a magnification power, and then focus the image while looking through the eyepiece. If the leaf is alive, then we'll see images like this. This white spot looks like the planet Saturn. Saturn is very far away from Earth, so to see a bigger image of it, we can use a telescope. First, we check star charts to find out where to look in the sky, and then we look through the telescope. Depending on how powerful the telescope is, we can then see pictures like this one taken by the Hubble telescope. Sometimes students confuse the names of microscopes and telescopes. One way to keep this straight is to think of a telephone which is used to talk with someone who is far away. Tele means far away, so telescopes help look at objects that are far away. Scientific instruments are tools that scientists use to discover things about nature, and engineers use to invent things. There are many scientific instruments, and they can be as different as microscopes and telescopes. We'll highlight those used to analyze the five things that scientists and engineers measure most frequently, which are mass, volume, distance, temperature, and time. In elementary school, we can think of mass as the same thing as weight. Although we also measure some of these every day, scientists and engineers use special devices and names for those devices. Let's say we're chemical engineers and have just invented this new solution. We want to know exactly how much is in this flask. To find the mass, we'll put a beaker on this balance. In science, we call this a balance, not a scale. Then we tear it. That means we reset the reading so it is zero. Next, we pour in the solution and find its mass is 63.4 grams. One way to remember that balance is the name of the tool used to measure mass is to think of an old-fashioned balance tool that looks like this. We can find the mass of this bowl by adding these pieces to the other bucket until they balance. Each of these pieces has its mass written on it. Once the tool is balanced, we add up the pieces in the bucket and find the bowl's mass. To summarize this scientific instrument, a balance measures mass. Next, let's find the volume of our solution. To do that, we'll use one of these graduated cylinders. They can hold different amounts of fluid, but all have markings that tell us the amount of fluid inside. We'll pour the solution from the beaker. Here is a close-up of the reading. The value is between 63 and 64 milliliters. It may seem lucky that the values for the mass and the volume are both between 63 and 64, but this is not luck. The metric system was designed to make things easy when working with water, since we use water a lot. For water, 1 gram of mass is equal to 1 milliliter of volume. This solution is almost all water, so its mass in grams is almost equal to its volume in millimeters. This cube is 1 centimeter on each side, so sometimes we call it a cubic centimeter. It has the same volume as 1 milliliter. And if it was made of water, then its mass would be 1 gram. You can remember this size because one side is about the size of a small fingernail. Since it's easier to do math with decimals than fractions, the metric system uses decimals. Plus, metric conversion tables are simpler than customary ones. To summarize this scientific instrument, a graduated cylinder measures volume. Next, let's say we're mechanical engineers and are making a part for a big machine that our company is inventing. This is a computer drawing of what we're going to make. The only requirements are that the left side has to be shaped like this red block. The right side has to be shaped like this orange cylinder. And the total length has to be 18 centimeters. The length for each piece doesn't matter, so long as the total length is 18 centimeters. So if the block is short, then the cylinder will be long. If the block is long, then the cylinder will be short. We happen to have a block of metal in our lab, so we'll use that instead of having to buy a new one. Let's measure its length so we know how much of the total 18 centimeters we've used up, and then we can calculate how long the cylinder needs to be. Although measuring tapes are handy for some things, when we need to be precise, we use a metric ruler. We read a metric ruler, just like we read a number line with decimals. We find that the block is 12.8 centimeters. We can calculate the length that the cylinder needs to be by subtracting 12.8 from 18, and we get 5.2 centimeters. After the cylinder arrives, we can check its length using a caliper, because the cylinder is short and will fit. The caliper shows us the length in millimeters. To go from centimeters to millimeters, we multiply by 10, so 5.2 centimeters is the same as 52 millimeters. It looks like this block is the right size. We confirm that the full length is 18 centimeters. We could have calculated the length of the cylinder by measuring it in inches, but that would require mixed fractions and subtracting fractions. To summarize this scientific instrument, a metric ruler measures distance, such as length. Next, let's say we're chemists getting ready to make a discovery about this blue solution. We need to see how hot it gets when it mixes with other chemicals that we added just a few minutes ago. This long rod is a temperature probe that displays the temperature of the solution. Sometimes we call these thermometers. Scientists and engineers prefer to use Celsius rather than Fahrenheit since it's easy to know how far away a temperature is from water's freezing point, which is 0 degrees Celsius, or how far away a temperature is from water's boiling point, which is 100 degrees Celsius. If we were geologists at a dig site and had just discovered a rock like this, we might want to know its temperature, so we would use a touchless thermometer like this one. To summarize this scientific instrument, a metric thermometer measures temperature. Like a microwave oven, some of our scientific instruments have built-in timers we can set. But often, we want a timer like a stopwatch instead. Let's say we're physicists studying how fast gravity makes a steel ball roll at the top of this track versus how fast it rolls at the bottom of the track. To find the answer, we will use this device that is shaped like a tunnel and has a stopwatch inside it that automatically starts as the ball rolls into the tunnel and stops as the ball rolls out of the tunnel. It can then figure out how long the ball is inside the tunnel and can then calculate its speed. At the top, the ball is going 61.9 centimeters per second. At the bottom, the ball is going 153.3 centimeters per second. To summarize this scientific instrument, a stopwatch measures how much time has passed. As we learn more about science and engineering, we will use scientific instruments a lot and learn about many others. Currently, the biggest scientific instrument in the world includes this disc, which is taller than a five-story building, and is connected to this blue tube that is over 15 miles long and goes in a big circle. This scientific instrument is used to study the smallest particles in nature. Scientists and engineers work with their scientific instruments in places called labs. A lab can include everything from a small room on Earth, with just one chemical engineer inventing a new solution, to the space station 200 miles above us, with many astronauts from countries all over the world working together on science experiments. Here's a summary of scientific instruments. Please pause this video to read this if you wish. If you're interested in practice tests that are similar to state exams, but with detailed, colorful explanations for each answer, then please see our apps in the App Store. Many of these are free and none expire or limit their function. Since we only make educational products for children, none of our apps have third-party advertising, in-app purchasing, or connect to the internet. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.